3, 2, we're live.
Welcome to Boulder, Colorado, everyone. It's great to have you along, and of course, Andy Hampsten. Andy, right on, man.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, Andy's first question was, he wants to know any 7-Eleven teammates jumping on this ride. Please let us know. You guys know how to do that. And this is the amazing world of Zwift and WBR. The power of bicycles alive and well. Andy, see, now you're already, I asked.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
We talked about less than 2.5 watts per kilo. So, Andy, and you're always going to see that icon. That's you. You're the only person that has that out there. So, everyone, thanks for joining us again. And so, we're going to ask, we had, I think, almost 300 people on the ride to start. Jens had 800. So, and of course, Jens, thank you for your work already. Matt Heyman, we heard you had a great ride. Just saw Lawson in New York. Our friend Charlie is here, and we all were so happy with how that went for Zwift. So, again, Lawson, you really dig in, and we appreciate you. So, I think Lawson is still riding. I'm always going to ask our techs to help me out and know what's going on. But obviously, Andy, everybody's here to talk to you. You know, everyone always talks about the Giro win and the Tour of Swiss wins, but people kind of forget you won on the Alpe d'Huez too, man.
Rode in France, that's the year you see me. We went to France quite a few times. It was fun to win one of those stages.
Yeah, that was an epic one though on the Alpe.
It was cool, yeah. It was fun. It was.
People always wonder, who was that woman in the car behind you?
I have no idea.
All right, we'll leave that as a mystery.
I was cycling in the 90s. Yep. Like there were a dozen women around. No one knew who they were.
Just like in Kobe's day, there's like the Dama Blanca.
Well, not quite that exotic.
See, you've got your old 7-Eleven jersey on. What did that mean to you, man? That era, the guys. I was going to start with, I forgot to tell you that I ran into Raul Alcala.
Oh, cool. So,
yeah,
well,
he's doing great. He's back in Monterey. He's got a new wife, Mercedes. And so he's doing really well.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Well, get him to come to our team reunion.
Oh, he wants to. And he gave me an email to give to you.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, yeah. So he'll come for sure.
Cool.
So you guys do that every year?
Every 5 years.
Oh, wow.
Every 5 years.
Nice. That's a good interval.
It's a good interval.
Yeah. Yeah, I know.
You think it's every year at this age.
Right, right. I hear you.
No, that was 5 years ago.
So we're coming up on another 8 year, and your Giro d'Italia win. That is something what I really love about you is how you stayed a man of the people here, not only in Boulder, but everywhere you go. It seems like you've really taken the time to not let that define you, being a Giro champion, you know?
Yeah, well, I spend as much time as I can in Italy.
Right.
Because
there you're a Giro champion.
because that's where the good living is.
Yeah, oh yeah.
The good living's not being a movie star, which I'm not. Taking out with friends and eating good food and drinking nice wine.
Your brother, still speaking of nice places, still living in Seattle?
Yes.
Yeah, cool.
Yes.
Is he in Waterford?
He is in... It's off Lake City Way. It's called Megabook.
Okay. And is he still building the Hampsten?
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, we really appreciate it. Like, so you made your name, you know, racing on the bike, and obviously he made his name in a different way. It's got to feel cool to ride around on a bike and it says Hampsten, but it's actually your brother's last name.
It is also my brother's last name. He could start the company if he wants. But
right, right.
It was great being a bike racer, but it's really fun making bikes and doing bike tours.
So how are you doing on your watts per kilo here?
I'm under.
So, yeah, okay, good. All right. So nice. We have a group bet, though. Like, everyone seems like you guys are riding well together out there. And, hey, if you want to tweet into our friends at GoZwift, please do, and I'll pass on a question to Andy. At this point now, I really like to talk about Andy as the whole person. The bike racing part of it. I mean, are you following along? I mean,
I spend more time than I should.
Yeah, good. That's exactly what I wanted to hear. You know?
If a race comes near me in Italy, I'll go see it.
Right.
But I get there. I get to Italy at the end of the Giro. Every now and then I'll go and see it.
I heard when Ross walked up, you had no problem just snapping into Italian mode.
I miss it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I can make grammatical mistakes all day long in Italian. It's no problem.
They let you roll with it over there?
They don't care.
Yeah, right. You're trying.
They just want to know what anyone's saying.
Right. Interesting.
It's not a grammar lesson.
So, Andy, when you are back in Boulder, then this is something that I don't know. You know, I think most of the people on this ride are already mega Hampsten fans, so you guys know Andy's story. But as a kid growing up in the Dakotas, can you imagine if I took your old whatever? Did you have one of those turbo trainers that you put on the rear wheel?
Rollers.
Okay. Yeah. Rollers. If I change your experience, you probably read books or something when you were doing it, or how'd you entertain yourself outside of just
trying not to fall off.
Okay, is there enough
watch
there?
Sweat come dripping down my nose.
Right. Just to be like going into triplets or Belleville mode, right? Where you're
it sounds like suffer. A hill. This is terrible.
Hey, you had enough wind to deal with, I would think, out there. But when imagine this technology, I guess, of course we couldn't. I couldn't imagine a cell phone. You know, we were pretty excited with walkie-talkies when I was a kid growing up here, right?
Yeah.
So, just think now how much maybe easier it was if you were out there trying to knock out a 20-hour training block week. And sometimes here in Colorado, when Andy and I are in Boulder right now, I guess I forgot to really mention that it's kind of a hometown.
It's freezing out this morning.
It's like 16 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah.
It's going to snow a couple feet at some point, and you're not going to be able to ride outside. So instead of going to, you know, Arizona, this is something you could do.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So you're on an island called Watopia.
Okay.
Yep. It's actually, what I love is, this is a real island. So it exists. All the topography that you see, that is real. But
okay.
None of the roads are. There's no infrastructure there because it's infested by snakes. Like there's a poisonous snake problem. And so it's under the control of Australia, I think. But they've said nobody lives here.
Wow.
But we do. And we'll have it at any given time, there's over 40,000 people that do this Zwifting. At a strong moment, you could have 4,000 people out there riding. So you'll see groups of 60 dudes come flying back the other way. I mean, that'll happen to us out here today as well. So,
cool.
And you'll see the flags representing all the nations.
Yeah, that's absolutely great. Thanks everyone for jumping in.
When we had Lawrence Ten Dam on, we did a special ride with him, and he had a couple of his regular riding buddies that he normally hangs out with met up with him, and they were friends through this platform, which I just found really, really... when you were a kid, you moved from the Dakotas, and you know I say Dakotas, Andy?
I was freaked out going from 5 feet to 6 feet.
That's what I was doing. You're like, I don't know, this is pushing technology here. Was it North or South Dakota?
North Dakota.
North Dakota. Okay.
Thank you for asking.
Right.
It's an enormous difference.
There really is. there really isn't in any way, I would think, at this point. But when you moved to Boulder, did you have a plan as far as, had you gone, made cycling contacts and already knew someone had a room to move into? Or did you just come in, I'm going to guess you had to have known a people or a Finney or something.
No, a buddy and I spent a summer in Madison, Wisconsin, where there's a lot of bike racing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I got into racing a lot.
Uh-huh.
And made friends there.
Right.
And then could move back in the following years.
So, this is where it gets good. I mean, you now can feel it, can't you? Like when you're on the blinds.
I'm at the point where I get my riding buddy to do all the talking. That's where I'm.
Well, you can start answering with more yeses and no's and right nodding.
Uh-huh.
Right. Good. Sit back in the group a little bit too. We did this race with Lawson Craddock in New York, where it was an open invite, 10K flat course. He's at this party in New York City with 300 people going bananas there. And he's kitted up in his Cannondale, it's an APAC kit, he's got his Cannondale, he got it on the machine, and he realizes that now he's going to be having hundreds of guys who have warmed up are you know, like fully ready to just throttle this thing. So that kid, do you know power at all? Like on your Hampsten, do you like to look at power while
you're
riding?
No, I have no idea. Used it all the time racing, because I always use heart rate.
Oh yeah. When they talk about this thing, FTP as well, you know, like knowing exactly how many watts you can average for an hour and be like realistically you're very high end, and then you can watch those numbers and realize like, okay, I've got this bumper here, like I've sat in the group, I haven't done any work, I can attack and know that I can stay within my FTP.
Okay, well now I'm gonna have to admit that I'm old enough and fortunate enough to have friends.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not so old that I've forgotten everything they told me. So once I was able to have a proverbial beard, I'm going out to with Bernardino.
Okay. Teammate, I love you.
Teammate, Claire. Hour and a half. Uh-huh. You know, he's always at the tour, he's throwing people off the podium. And I thanked him for all of us for doing that.
Uh-huh.
Keeping the podiums clean. So I just let flow, kids these days.
Sure.
Power meters, watts, looking at numbers. It was hilarious. He just let loose that he would mop the floor with racers these days.
Yeah.
They were
yeah.
so fixated uh-huh. on their numbers in a race situation.
That's fascinating.
But this is different.
But I love that though. And I believe him, you know, it's tactic as well. And
especially if they're going off their, you know.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely.
Mr. Froome is fantastic, but known whether it's true or not,
yeah.
we're just looking at his numbers.
Yeah, that's really.
So he was his point. You know, the point was, well, if he's so fixated on the number, I don't care. But I know he's going to freak out if he goes over his number. I'll play with him on that level.
Sure, I could take him out of his comfort zone. That's interesting. It really is. So I remember during the day, Andy, you used to come back with always the greatest of the advice from the Italian sages out there. And one thing I remember, do you still believe that every hour of sleep that a racer gets in a stage race before midnight counts as two?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, you know, okay, that still holds true.
Completely yeah. whacked out. And, you know, if you're right. on a sleep schedule that has to be, you know, we're getting up at 7 to eat for the 10 o'clock race.
Right.
Absolutely.
Well, you must have done some crazy stages back in the day at the Giro. Even the Coors Classic, double days.
Double days were the worst.
Yeah.
Especially a team time trial.
Totally. And they always had to double day. It always is going to be at least a time trial, but at worst, a team time trial and an 80K stage.
It's a different bike. It's mechanics don't sleep.
Right. Yeah. But if you think about it too, Andy, an 80K stage is worse than a 160K stage because they go so pretty hard.
Yeah.
Right.
And finally, the tour, you know, if there's a team time trial, it's on one day.
Right.
It's a full
event. Yeah. And I like the spectacle of that. I mean, I remember when, you know, back in the early days of your amateur career, it's funny how it's a U23 career now.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But your amateur career at that point, the team time trial, like, man, I bet. When the Soviets came over and the East Germans came over for the Coors, it was like,
F1
machine. Right, yeah. Would you look at their technology, being impressed by their bikes or weirded out by their bikes?
The top American racers.
Yes, real worlds, you've never seen 70s. A Czech team, and they've got some crazy.
We were convinced that Sukrochenkov, you know.
Oh, Sergei.
He had horse implants in his calf.
Oh, really?
Look at him.
What was your source?
Look at how fast he goes.
Yeah. Well, what
he had these
tenderloins
added to any human being's calf.
Yeah.
Obviously.
What do you think?
And he was nice. How did he do
it? He was such a good dude. What would have happened if Suko would have raced Eno in the Tour de France in both?
Panasonic.
Okay.
So he has a superior.
Right. So he's got a good, a great right director, good sports
right,
doctor.
Right there. Or put his whole team on.
Right.
Panasonic.
Right. Yeah. Put Yuri Baranov, remember that dude?
Yeah.
Right.
And what I mean politically, it's not degrading at all to them. They, you know, their rules were anything goes, but they were, but not cheating,
right?
Not underhanded things.
Sure.
They were all so desperate to be on their national teams.
Well, I mean,
and so used to competing against each other that it was a more honest racing. It was just attrition.
You know, gosh, what an interesting time to look back on. You know, I know people want to talk about this Euro, or they want to talk about Tour de Suisse, but that time, this is where you're 22, you know very well, we've all been looking at Bennett Eisner's house, right?
Yeah.
And we've all seen the magazines, like the good and the bad, right? I think Eisner was very much trying to open up our eyes that there's something more going on.
He set the tone, yeah.
Right, yep. And so we all looked at these guys with a certain understanding of like, so they're an Air Force colonel or whatever, right? Oleg Logman is an Air Force colonel. And you're like, he doesn't even know anything about planes, you know, like, but it's a job, and it's a fake job. But then you're at the wrong end of the stick on that deal, as this young American trying to make Olympic teams and trying to become a pro, you know, trying to make the big step. Well, you're having to get your ass kind of kicked when these guys that you know are using things and getting things that you're not.
They're getting a lot of support.
They're not getting love.
I knew more of these Germans and Czechs when I was a pro. Teammates with them, and, you know, long evenings with no race going on. And I would hear, it's the worst.
Yeah.
Just making their national teams was the hardest racing they had to do, and the psychologically most disturbing things they had to do in their lives.
Yeah.
It was
terrible. Well, then let's turn that around.
Yeah, but they love coming through. To bring that around, I, as an amateur, could turn pro. I did the proverbial carrot in front of me. Mm-hmm. They, were trying to make the Olympic team and national teams just kind of had their life. So it was easier for me.
Right. I mean, if you think about that, too, what they were really at that point, the unspoken deal, or it was a spoken deal, probably, is that, look, you get that Olympic gold medal, dude, and you've got the golden ticket for life. You're going to keep the apartment right above the wall. You're going to get the stipend of 2,500 euro a month for food. You know what I mean? It's like, wow. What? I mean, it's out to pasture. I'm on welfare up there, dude. But look what you get to do, man. Like Cingali. How's Cingali going?
Cingali's fun, right?
Yeah.
Bike tours in Italy.
Right. And so you
hang out with fun people.
Who are more than happy to be there. It's a small group, and that's your life. That's not talk about, if you want to look at winning, thanks everyone for joining us here on the 24 Hours of Swiftathon. Obviously Andy Hampsten, and kind of talking more about life today. I think it's a good time to talk about that kind of stuff.
I'm waking up.
It's a little early and cold here, to tell you the truth. When we rolled in, I think it was about, as we said, 16 degrees Celsius. So, hey, Andy, I have a question. I love this question. Thank you for this one from our Zwifters. What's the best cycling book that you've ever read or enjoyed?
I have a four-year-old, so I read a lot of books.
So it's Mike and Mike.
Not necessarily the books I wanted.
You ever read The Race? The Danish guy.
Trip.
Yeah.
Dutch. I loved it. Absolutely loved it, because he got in the head.
Yeah.
One of my big regrets is he asked me to write a foreword, and I was too busy. I love that one.
Oh, man. That would have put it over the top for me, that's for sure.
So right now I'm
just hand it back, hand it back to the team guard.
Go! Sorry, teammates. I apologize for all of those.
Need a push?
Yeah, please. Eros Poli joining us.
Come on, let's go. Push me too.
On the downhill, I'll push you.
Go. Okay, stay there. Easy. Easy now. Okay, this is good.
I'll tell you once, brave, a year or two brave, after.
Recovered, yeah. Ready to do the job.
See, you need a coach.
Oh, gosh, don't move it.
When I quit, Robobank came to my area of Tuscany to train.
Yeah.
You know, January. And I trained quite a bit. I think I'd quit for 2 years already. For one whole year. Like, oh, Andy, come out with us. Cool. Yeah. You know, I know all the roads. When you drop me, I'll just go to a cafe and drink something and go, boom. So we do two hours. And we're taking 15-minute pulls, 2x2. Just, you know, nice. I can't talk, but they can talk. But my pull, come in the back, it happens at 2 hours. We go to Masamariki.
Oh, okay.
Pretty hard hill, just like this. I know the road's really well down a hill, and it's really steep. As soon as it's steep, I'm done. So I go back to the car, you know, and I know the people in the car, hold on to the car for a kilometer or two, pedal a little bit, you know, keeping up with the boys, and then it's rolling up, down, flat, climb towards Imanjabibi, but 6 hour ride, holding on to that one hill, I could finish the whole road. I mean, that's the difference.
I did
zero.
Yeah, yeah.
They did the hardest hill. But look at me, right?
Oh, okay. So, just take it easy. It's not one. You have another.
Not any sprinter hung on in the Pyrenees or anything. But it makes a difference.
Is that thought of Yanka? Does it kick up?
Modern dust.
Andy, was that something that you enjoyed riding on, that gravel in Italy? The white
boats? I love it. Yeah. As soon as I retired, I designed a bike with my brother. Called Strada Bianca just to be
that right. Was the first model name.
I just grumbled, I want to ride, ridden every road, they're all great, but I want to put all these gravel roads together. I just needed fatter tires. It's just we didn't invent any, it's a 70s road bike.
Sure, totally.
Geometry.
Yeah.
Modern tubing.
Hey, really quickly for everyone joining us, this is Eros Poli, our Italian friend. He's with Ibrahima and obviously all is well. He's going to be riding next, to tell you the truth. So, but he's a very molto bien, a very good person to have always with us, and we really love Jack.
Ask him about food and wine, he'll never shut up.
Yeah, we were sitting at the wrong end of the table with our friend Katie from WBR, and we're going to. Andy, I definitely have
last
to talk
night,
to you. Pizza locale here. Yeah. It was so nice. So really nice to get to work.
Pizza, Italian, pretty. Yep. Just missing the cup at the hand, that's okay.
Well, you look like a very nice conversation at your end of the table. Everyone is enjoying your stories. Now, as you can see, you shifted back in the group a little bit during the story, didn't you? That's perfect. That really is.
Talking about how great I am, I just went backwards.
So we had a chance to talk with Katie earlier about what World Bike School Week is all about. And this Swift-a-con is really, honestly, raising money. I'm going to check in with Katie and let everyone know how we're doing, but working hard on getting bikes to Africa.
Awesome.
And sometimes, I mean, you know me for long enough that I make things too complicated sometimes, you know, like trying to tell a story, and sometimes you just have to stop. And sometimes I think it's really that simple. You would trust and do your research and look into who they are and see the materials that they put out there to try to show you what they're doing, and know that people like, remember old Alex Candelaria? He's a huge WBR person. He's over in Hawaii. I got to get Alex out there swifting with us. But he's the kind of person that has actually gone to Africa with some of his colleagues and worked with the Mechanics Center and built bikes and rode bikes with those people. You know Alex. You know what kind of dude he is. That's the kind of person that we're talking to. So. I really love knowing that, you know, you're on board for trying to make this world a better place. There's never been a better time.
Cool. Yeah. It's great. It's great to be able to have that. Thank you, everyone, for helping out. great cause.
Well, in all honesty, Andy, this is like I always think. So, you know, always I'm sure people want you to sign a pink jersey for them or take time to do something for them. When you do this, this 50 minutes or hour ride, what you're doing is giving so much attention and bringing eyeballs and really, you know, this is a karma rebate for you. It really is, because I know how much Katie appreciates you coming. And, you know, a lot of these people out there. And once again, if you have any questions, Charlie is ready to, I think Charlie might be coming in hot with one right now. Thanks, Charlie. So, interesting. I like this perspective. Do you consider your riding to be training or riding?
Riding.
Absolutely. I knew the riding. Answer on that one.
You know, and I'll be short on time, and hey, I've been ridden for 5 days. It's 3 o'clock, I have time for an hour and a half. And it's called, boom, Chapman Drive. Go up the canyon.
That's part of why living in Boulder is so cool,
yeah,
too.
I mean, ideally, it's a few buddies, it's a few hours.
Right.
In Italy, it's all about which offices shall we stop at, meeting right. cafes.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And it can be as much time in the cafe as on the bike.
What is the signal? Like, is there a boss of the ride, a jefe, who says, like, okay, let's go?
No, we just see it wherever. Everyone's late. And then it's which office are we going to?
Right. That's great.
Let's try the new one. You know, an hour and 15 minutes away.
Isn't that's one of the beautiful things about Europe, is the ability to just access all of these different things so, you know, so close, and you can kind of just keep branching out and keep branching
out. Yeah, people are riding. It's the middle of nowhere. Yeah. We go away from the ocean, and it's always people riding, always jump in with someone or help a tourist
right.
with direction and start a nice conversation.
I want to go back to the book question that we had earlier.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't finish that.
Well, yeah, no, I kind of interrupted, so.
The one I refer to maybe the most was Sling the Badger with Roger Moore, because it's that great fratricide story.
But isn't it to you to be a character in that book? How well do you think you're, I mean, I got to admit, that ESPN 1660 thing, that was 30 for 30
yeah.
thing, I'm sorry, that was done. I thought it was really well done.
Yeah.
I thought
and so did the author.
Well, good. I'm really glad to hear that. Because what was really fascinating to me, Andy, is you seem like the only guy who played it down the middle, true to the heart. As far as Paul Carucci had his story that was definitely seemed, you know, unique to me, and everybody else was defending their side. You were the only guy that came in. You were like the Switzerland. You and Nicky Leuchtenberg.
They should have gotten those.
We should have gotten Nicky Leuchtenberg. Remember him?
And Guido Winter.
Yeah, totally.
They were neutral.
But they were definitely neutral, but so were you, and the way you told the story was without bias. Of course, everything
without
was
bias, but I wasn't
your
neutral.
Eyeballs.
I chased down Eno going into Sardegna. Yeah.
Oh, no. I don't mean your
so
race.
So, yeah, during the race, no.
No. I mean in the recounting of the story. And you know how everyone has their own angle and take. But, man, I love the way, Andy, as someone who's a kid growing up in Boulder, do you know how we were just, I mean, we obviously weren't watching it live, but just knowing
knowing that
was a part of this thing, you know, like, it was unbelievable.
But it was really, really, really fun. All the racing I did was really fun. And I hear a lot of reviews. You know, I used to talk about sacrifice and how hard it is, and my life's really difficult. And I can't eat burritos in Europe. It was so much fun.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm out of it long enough that looking back at stories or reading different books, you know, I'm reminded how much fun it was.
Yeah. And that, obviously, you know how you really see that? Is that you spend a lot of time there. Now, you know, it's interesting to me that some riders just don't really get that. It just doesn't happen. It doesn't click for them that way.
So I understand the culture. So when I was a neo-pro, I thought all the pros were ganging up on me. They're all these mean Italians swearing at me for causing crashes. Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't understand. I mean, I could ask Eros Is that where they see? No, they're complaining about their mom. They're looking at you. They're waving their arms. You guys are way too sexy.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's quite a bit of that.
That's really interesting. That. You know how fragile the psyche is for a young American going over to Europe and not understanding the language and not, you know, like when they ask you if you want a sandwich, you think they're asking if you want a pastry.
Yeah.
And, you know,
it's 200 other nervous thoroughbreds.
Right. Yeah, right.
Why did they put us all in the same road?
The roads were much safer. Actually, you didn't really spend a ton of your time racing in Holland or Belgium.
Every year I would. That changed dramatically. With road footage?
Yeah, all that stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, Italy didn't really get on board with much as most European nations, did they? Like, it's not, are they?
No. Mow everything over in your car and go.
When you go there, where do you fly into?
Into Pisa. It's another bubble. It's like Boulder.
Isn't the airport there called the Marco Polo?
No, that's Venice.
Okay, all right.
It's Galileo Galilei.
Oh, even kind of cooler.
Yes.
Yeah. How much of you? Thank you. Another couple. I'm good. Thanks for the questions. There we go. I'm going to guess that you. Okay, I'm just going to ask it. So, what is your FTP? Do you know what FTP is?
No.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I used to train with maximal testing. You tell me my watts per body weight.
So, all right, we'll get back to that one.
Then you tell me, don't sprint, just try attacking on the way out.
Max, do you stay in touch with him?
Yeah, not
a little bit, yeah, but. Luckily, you don't have to go see your old teammate, Eric Hyman.
Not yet.
Right?
They're still working.
It's like Eric is...
I'll go straight there.
Oh, man, I know. It's like, that's
surgery and jokes.
Yeah, right.
When we had our...
You're like, just book me on however we get to Park City. And,
we had our team reunion last year. We went to Napa Valley and pretended we were movie stars and told the same old lies. Some of us flew in a day early. Jens and Dalgado from Scandinavia, and I met them at the airport, and we just spent a night in San Francisco. Next morning, Tom Schuler, Jeff Bradley, and Roy Nickman, drove in or flew in. We all had lunch together. We went over, who's coming, who's not coming. We said, no one's heard from Eric. No, I haven't heard. It's like, that's too bad.
Please. For me, no water.
Oh, okay.
Prosecco.
No, no, no.
Wine.
Okay. For you, Chianti.
Chianti.
We can do that.
Okay.
Amante.
So we call him up.
Director.
Yeah. Like, hi, guys. Yeah, I can't come. Yeah, sorry. Hey, you know what? I'm so sorry. Can I just call you back? I'm like, what a flake. He won't even talk to
us. Wasn't this? Yeah.
He calls back 45 minutes later. Hey guys, how's it going? Yeah. Sorry I couldn't call. I was in surgery.
Oh, yeah.
And he answers
he
the
still
phone.
Took the call.
He still took
I know.
That's a stupid phone call. So, in surgery.
So,
I don't know if that's bad PR for him.
No, I think it's awesome PR because he's one of the greatest. Why did you guys call him Gomer? Wasn't that his nickname?
Yeah, happy go lucky.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And I think it might be speed skating days. I think so.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I met him when I was a junior bike racer, and I'd work in a bike shop in the morning and train in the afternoons when my buddies were out of school.
In Madison.
In Madison.
There we go. Goes back to that.
So,
yeah.
He and family are with other top international speed skaters that were invited to train with them. And they'd go to bike races as an easy workout in their day. So I got to train with these guys. Get to know them. They've been there for months. Swedes, this Australian guy, Austrians. And they would tell me stories about how they can't keep up training. But then they go out drinking at Scott.
Yeah.
Almost every night. He would, big guy,
yeah.
Drink them under the table. You know, lay down, throw up. Not all the time.
But you could.
But regularly.
Yeah.
They're like, oh my God, we can't keep up with Eric Hutton.
Yeah.
On any turkey. He's phenomenal. And, but he's only calm.
Yeah.
It's just not so
a
under pressure.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Like none of these people said, yeah, well, I saw him really pissed. You know,
right.
Just no story of him ever.
I would say, I would 100% say the same thing about you, Andy. But it is incredibly rare that the heroes that you have as a kid that you meet are awesome then, and they remain awesome into your adulthood. And for me, that's you and Eric Hyde for sure. So, that being said, and once again, thank you for your questions. Here's our next one. Do you work in cycling now?
No.
That's a hard
one. It's not a work. In Boulder, Colorado. But I do support the work my brother does at Hampsten Cycles. And I do actually have to put time in on it. I run Shingali tours.
Sure. Yep.
Talking to clients, booking hotels.
And run them, actually being on the tours.
I can do it in my cafe.
Yeah.
Well, doing the tours, and that's why I do the work. It's really, really fun, as we all know, riding a bike, with people having fun. And showing them the offices around Italy.
When's your next tour?
May, late May.
And it's already sold out?
That one is. One's always sold out right away, and then one's empty.
Right, so just get
the other
side. We share a mutual friend, Scott Nickel, and Rob Coppolino. Wasn't Rob a guy for you too?
He was a guy.
Always need help when you're running a thing like that. How many people does it take? Six people, maybe?
Usually six.
Some riding, some driving.
20, some, you know, a driver, four or five on the bike.
Yep.
You know, we try to get 20-some in the group.
Right. That sounds awesome. Yeah. It really does. So, okay, final question from this batch. Charlie, if you have more, let me know. How has racing changed since you retired?
Well, I guess I don't know, right? Because I'm not right in it.
That's a great answer.
It's faster because there's no longer slope periods, typically. So there's, you know, attacking 50 k's an hour for an hour until something goes, which is... Yeah, that could have happened in my years. It got a lot faster from the 80s when an average never meant much of anything. Just like, oh, wow, we chased a break. It's easier to go 47 k's an hour with Finesto chasing a break all day than accelerating, going slow and then very fast. But I just see it consistently faster now. With the real key, often the climbing speeds that people are going on, and now it seems more predictable how people are climbing at a more equal rate.
But great, and thanks again for the questions. Oh, another one coming in. Thank you, Charlie. I like this one. The poster. Do you know the photographer that took that picture?
Yes, Sergio Panatz.
Okay, yeah.
Crazy old.
Do you think he made some money off that photo?
No.
Really? I mean,
I bought it from him.
You
made him double what he asked me. It was a pit in that.
Oh, okay, good call.
That shot.
That's how you get out in front of things, man. Right, exactly. So, if someone wanted to buy one of those posters, do you have any idea how they do it?
Write to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how do you remain such a man of people? It's beyond.
They can write to my brother. But...
That might be better, actually. Contact Hampsten.
No, because I'll sign it. So I can sign 172.
Oh, don't you have a
cash?
He gives
them away those bikes. But they're all in my house.
Right.
So people want me to sign it. To someone, so it's useless for Steve to send it back to me.
See, I always thought in the autograph collector world, but I never think that Jim Betsy. It's just better Andy
Hampsten.
I guess you have to indulge us and let us be fans. Hey, by the way, it's cool that Boulder Cycles allow us to be here.
It is awesome.
We're doing business in here. No problem.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't care at
That's
all.
That's what it is.
Yeah,
like, oh, hey!
Yeah, welcome. it's really nice of them to allow Katie, worked really hard with Brandon here to put this all together.
So Brandon has a cross race to win this afternoon.
Yes, I heard you talking to him about that. So, I'm sorry, getting to the question here. Going up or down the Gavia in a snowstorm? That's why I got on the poster.
I'm down. Yeah. And I raced it. You know, the tactic that morning was go up at 95% because it's going to be unimaginable in the downhill.
So,
and that's how I raced it.
So, in all honesty, I want to take a step back there because I know that day. How much time have we got left here? 40 minutes in, 41 minutes in. Okay, we have time for this. I always think that one of the most undervalued, underappreciated people who've worked in American Cycling as a racer, a director, he's done it all pretty much, not a mechanic. Is Mike Neal.
Sure.
Yeah, he knew where I was going.
Oh, yeah. Heroes are like that.
Yeah, right, right. Mike is alive and well. But
Mount Shasta?
Yeah, Shasta. I think it's called Fort Washington, but it's sort of like in that Eureka. Northern California.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Still coaching. That's great.
Yeah, yeah. So, Mike, that day, in, I think the story goes, you stop it when I'm off track, but the story goes that you guys maybe prepared a little bit better that day and had done your homework and knew what was going on up there and had to put real gloves, legitimate gloves, not just some lame Italian
stuff. We went shopping.
You went shopping.
We're in ski town, ski area of Italy, down in the valley.
And Mike whips out the corporate guard, I mean, obviously,
to clear the road.
So he's smart.
The whole, they just went to little shops, Gore-Tex gloves, Wovol gloves, and we had great insulated clothes, but we were all thinking of the descent. So what he did, every rider prepared a Musette bag of clothing that Jim Ockwitz, the manager, would have one came from the top. There's two hollow colors, but we'll be all over. And I had clothing in that bag, and also in the phone car that if I went well, we'd be right behind me. So I could put things on when I wanted.
And Mike is
the other guys couldn't count on it.
Right. Yeah.
Because there's one other car servicing everyone on a huge mountain. So we were the only team that did that. Johan Vandeveld went over the, he was first to the top of the Gavia. And his team car handed him a plastic green jacket.
It wasn't Roy.
No, Roy Keek was, he caught me when I was trying to get my neoprene gloves through my frozen rain jacket that I picked out of the model.
Okay,
so he and I crested together 1 minute or so back. Because Vandeveld was in a breakaway. The last one in a breakaway. But I never even saw him. He finished 47 minutes later. He was looking at winning, and he was he just, his director was handing him a cap, a dry cotton hat, plastic green jacket. Just say, get on with it. Other teams, from that day on, every team car has a rain bag of every rider in the bag. That was invented in the office.
That's what almost invented, can you almost say invented by Mike Neal?
Oh, yeah.
See?
Oh, yeah.
And where's the credit?
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, hey, Rafa, you should make a Mike Neal bag. Just saying.
That would be that's a great idea.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
That's
the idea. He convinced us not only think about the downhill, you know, for me and the other guys, it's equally important. And they were going to help you get to the bay thing. Get everything good to help me with the base of the climb. But he had us convinced us put that forward lanolin all over our bodies.
Which
not
is
our
just
legs.
Sheep?
It's sheep.
Sheep.
It's the
some it's oil or something.
Oil from wool.
Yeah.
It's impervious to water. So you can put it on our
Sheep? Yeah.
Everywhere. Right. Because we'll be soaked to the skin.
Right. It's the equivalent of covering yourself in Vaseline.
Yeah, no, it won't wash away.
Vaseline would wash away.
And you have to use bronzer. You have to use something with oil to take it off.
It's like
we hated it, but we all did it. Because Mike Neal convinced it's, you know, it's all about the downhill stuff. Yeah.
Which is pretty much exactly how we would say it. It's all about the downhill statement.
He was so good. He treated us like thoroughly.
I was going to say, he is the racer whisperer.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, I love having you with us, Andy, and being so open to these great stories. And, you know, I think that this means that we're inside 5 minutes to go. Yeah, great. So.
I'm looking for, thanks for the lead out, guys.
Yeah. It's been really, really fun having you with us.
Awesome. You sit on. I'll take care of you. No, really. Thank you, everyone, for coming out from so many cool places.
Yeah, I just, for everybody, just want to say, this question comes in. Who was your favorite director sportif?
Neil Bedeidemann. The way the races went.
Neil was the most spiritual of them.
Neil, right? I had the most fun racing.
Right. Who was the Neil. Tactically, like, oh, well, we were talking about Paul Cuici and obviously, you wrote the Neymar as well?
No, I didn't.
Okay, I won't put words in your mouth. Favorite is an interesting word.
No, Coakley.
Coakley, yeah.
The most exciting race was that 86 Tour. I didn't win, but I don't know how he kept it together. He couldn't control Hino. LeMond was, you know, sticking with the team plan, but that's
he must have been
just going
to
listen
to the Beatles in their heyday. You know,
but he could manage
John
the rest of
going
us.
One way and McCartney
like,
going
this
another.
This is what's happening. I tell you guys every day, you have to fit. We'll talk in the morning. He had great meetings, but you guys have to figure it out. Mm-hmm. Now we know what he knows doing. He's now told us he changed the plan. Most directors would have just had a hissy fit. How did he really kept it together?
So, what's next for you? Are you going back over there?
More coffee, you know.
More coffee, yeah. Up to a month. Yeah. Are you a ritualistic person? Do you have like your eight places that you go to? Or you will?
I am. Three. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and I live near downtown, so.
Right.
That's what probably usually gets me.
One
a little burrito place on the bike path.
Oh yeah.
In Foothills Highway.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just great.
Yeah. That's a definitely an off the beaten path kind of place.
That's burrito in town.
I have a lot of old friends that when they talk about Boulder, they're like, hey, is the gondolier still exists?
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah.
So you go to Juanita's all the time?
Yeah, right. I miss Juanita's a lot. Do you know Kimberly Baldwin?
Yeah.
Yeah. She used to be a waitress at Juanita's. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. Isn't that insane? It seems like Juanita's have been gone way, way too long. That would be definitely a Boulder throwback place. I know the question I wanted to ask, Colin. When you moved here, what was the first paying job that you had? Non-cycling. But did you work at a restaurant? Did you work at a sports store?
I worked for the Beating Edge Outdoor Clothing Store on Walnut.
I was just going to say, by J.J. McKay.
Yeah. They made the world's best climbing parka, ice climbing parka.
In
Roll, I went in there looking for fabric to construct a Gore-Tex jacket.
Uh-huh.
And they hired me just to answer the phone and ship.
Wow.
And it was, you know, I still look at all the great climbing gear there is now. They haven't done better than with the Beating Edge gear. Sewing it in the roof.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was full of crazy, smart people. It was pretty fun stuff. Still.
It's interesting, you know, exactly. That's one of the great things about being here is that there are so many talented people at what they do, you know? And then it's this, we could use a little more diversity. Say, Andy.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, Andy Hampsten, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you
for helping. Great time. Keep up the great riding. Thank you, Swift.
Andy, that was freaking awesome.
It was awesome. They really go to the finish.
Yeah, they're going to keep going.
Just like a real ride.
That's the craziest thing. We'll be right back. Welcome back. It's been already a great morning for us here in Boulder, Colorado, but it just got a whole lot better. We'll talk a lot about who he's representing and where he comes from, but ladies and gentlemen, this is Olympic gold medalist, Tour de France stage winner, world champion, Eros Poli. Eros, welcome to Boulder, man.
Ciao a tutti. Hey. Ciao, amici miei, my friend. Hi, welcome.
Hey, did you, nice to see Andy Hampsten, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was pretty fun.
Yeah, good, okay. Good. So, when you came, 1984, Olympic Games in Los Angeles, the team time trial was won by the Italians. It was not even close. They were one of the teams, really, that if there hadn't been an Eastern boycott of the games, that you guys still could have beat the Russians or the East Germans in 84. But you were on that team.
Oh, that team, yes.
Now,
3 years ago, a long time ago.
The
result was amazing because we were the first team to go under the water in 2 hours. But we won the 100 kilometer in 1 hour 52 minutes, 1 hour. Four guys can imagine this too, amazing speed.
Oh yeah.
What a big evolution. The new bikes with the lenticular wheels, small frame front wheel, 24 inch.
Double disc, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, right. So, did you come over, I remember an Italian named Roberto Panini. Okay?
Yeah.
So, did you come over in 1984 and do Course Classic before?
No, I wasn't there, no.
Okay, but you know so many
times. I was there, my first time in Colorado was in 86.
For World
the World Championship. We were second. We beat the Russian, but we was beat for the Dutch team. So the Dutch team was the winner in Colorado Springs, second Italy, third Russian. Then, next year, 87, we beat the Germans. We beat the Russians, we beat everybody.
Yeah.
The gold in 87, so it was good revenge because on the gold in every game, no Russian, no Germanist. So
yeah, sure.
So we was a really strong team.
Yeah, Eros, what an era. I have to ask, obviously as a world champion, you wear the bands. Now when you see, and I love this, and I support this myself, but when you see the Olympic champions will wear, like Sanchez wears just a gold band. Maybe you could put a gold band right here.
Probably, yeah.
Just an idea.
Yeah.
Hey, Joao. Joao, he's our friend from Ngamba.
Yes.
One of the many friends that we have from Ngamba. But I know that you're busy, but we need to get some new jerseys ordered up for okay? So no, I always think in cycling, world champion is the biggest prize. But in the world, the Olympics are the biggest prize.
Yes, so, prize.
When you are introduced, if I'm bringing you out onto a stage to talk for a dinner, but you only have one thing that I would use as a your thing, like Olympic champion, Tour de France stage winner, or world champion. What do you choose?
It's not to ask because.
How about just champion?
Yes. No, my dad told me, hey. When I decided to leave the school to become a rider, to do my first world championship in 1980 in Mexico City, I decided to leave the school, to left the school for the bike. My dad.
You said 1980. 1980.
My first world championship. I was junior, 17 years old.
On the road?
On the road. But 17K time trial, okay. I was 21 years old. Bicycle is our job. I 21, when we decide to do something serious. The day before, you told 21 years old, I want to go better. So, it's done.
Yeah.
We try to keep going.
What do you think you would have done if you weren't a cyclist at that point?
Yeah. You know, it's probably I was too young to still not understand what I'd done.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Okay, so I'm sorry, go ahead. Yeah.
So, riding, I was team for the next 5 years, for the next four years in the Olympic team, for the next Olympic game, so at the end so it was bad, but it's good. The bike didn't arrive in Italy, in Korea. And so because they forgot the bike, put the bike to South Africa. So
and you're flying from Italy to Korea?
With no bikes.
With no bikes.
No bikes. So the bikes arrived just 2 days for the race. So, better zone, no contract to be pro. My career was near hand. So I raced my last race in Australia, this year, out with my wife Michelle. And then I started a new life, new year. No, the Tondo.
The Tondo.
The Tondo?
Sure. Yeah.
When we won the Giro with Franco Chiocci in 91.
Right.
Cipollini won 6 days this year. 92, MGGB, with Museo,
yeah.
Ballerini, Diaspora, big team.
Cipollini. And maybe one of the first teams that was a Belgian Italian.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Uh-huh. Italian sponsor. At the end of here, 93, our team, the camp. Mercatone 1, Saito, e l'altro parte team, MG Tecnogini. I was in the Mercatone 1.
20 Rominger to the other, right?
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So, 94. I was only in the team without Manuel Cipollini. Cipollini had a back crash in the Vuelta, 94. The Vuelta this period was in May. Mm-hmm. Was the last May, the last Vuelta in May. So, we go to the Tour de France with our leader. My leader was Silvio Martinello, now commentator for the writer for the RCS Sport. So, this happened. Probably one of my best victories in my life.
Yeah.
The moment too, because it was just me. But for this, I love gold, I love the Olympic gold medal, but also, the moment too gave me something different.
Yeah.
Either one is just simple stage.
So we're going back now. I'm gonna ask our crew to help me out too here in a second. But first off, that was a beautiful, beautiful. And if you ever have a chance to go on an Ingamba tour with this man, this is what you get. This kind of conversation. The question was simply, how do you want to be introduced? Tour de France winner, Olympic gold medal champion. Or world champion, and that's how awesome the experience is when you hang around a real champion like yourself. So, how are you doing?
Can you drop this? It's too much for me. I need a glass of Prosecco.
Oh yeah. Prosecco. Huh? You know what? Andy Hampsten said he'll go get it for us. But no, we do need a. Hey guys, can we get some water when we have a chance here?
There's no wind here.
Yeah, no.
It's cold wind. You're big car, yes.
So, guys, can we get some water when we have a chance? That'd be awesome. Thanks.
I see you.
Yeah, exactly. I thought they were leaving us there. You know that the gold thing is you. That you can see your Ingamba kit. It looks like you're closing. How many times in your career did you have to close?
It was my job.
Yeah. Your job was really, thanks. So there you go, though. Having done your job. Who was the greatest Italian racer of all time, in your opinion?
I love Jenny Bruno. Marco Fortana.
Yeah, Marco is for the heart, right?
Yeah. I was strong, really strong, was amazing strong.
Yeah.
Forget the bus story. He was a strong man.
Absolutely.
Mentally, yeah. And legs.
Right.
Up the mountain, amazing.
Yeah.
I hate him.
He must have made your life miserable at times.
You know the Sioux Falls went for 10 attack.
I just need one, brain. Actually. Yeah,
thanks. Oh,
oh,
dang. Oh, God, tell me. Come on.
You never waited for me on the Vontu, so there's your water. That's no grappa in it.
No, sick for grappa. You fought that.
Sick for grappa. No, this is, you're doing 299 watts.
300 watts. So easy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Too fast.
Come on, right? That's good. 300 watts. Easy. Hey, for the week. Saw some way now.
Why are you doing this big climb? There's a different road.
Why not? You should. They do easy. Crosswind now. Careful. Stay on the right side. Stay here. Oh,
that's your sponsor's jersey on.
Andy, I have a feeling.
Warner, what?
I have a feeling we could do something like that for you as well. Our friends at Zwift have been really inclusive with obviously with the relationship that we have.
Slowing it down for me.
This was the kind of guy that made your life miserable. When you made his miserable in the mountains, he was riding the front all day.
That's why we could be great friends.
Yeah, sure. You never really met. Yeah. Two different ends of that spectrum, for sure. Yeah. So, it's amazing. We were just asking Eros about his favorite Italian racer of all time. And you know, you could see the answer when he said Gianni Bugno at first, but then stopped and said, no, Pantani. You know, like,
and see, this period or in football time?
Of all time.
It's a little hard in Italy.
Right, and see, that's, I think, like, maybe when you said Fausto Coppi.
Yeah, but this is the boss.
Yeah.
This boss.
From the riders of your era. Uh-huh. For you, who resonates, I got to think that you would be a Fausto Coppi was an artist. You appreciate the artist part of being a cyclist. Is he your guy?
Well, you know, then it's, you know, which one am I? You live in Italy enough that it's either my
Gino
Fausto Coppi or Gino Bartali. I like Gino's grit, but now I'm hearing a lot of stories about Fausto off the bike. Uh-huh. They're just fantastic.
Yeah.
Like, he really, you know, he took the fall in the press
at
the end of his career, but they both did really cool things.
There's some great stories, actually. Eros, please chime in about Gino Bartali and his efforts during World War II.
Yeah, that's a put double inside.
Yeah,
help you,
which is beyond what any other cyclist that we know of.
Yeah,
I give the full nod to him.
Yes,
as a human being, you can't touch him. But let's just talk about my face.
Okay, there you go. Right on. So, yeah, it was fun. We had a chance. To ask Eros as well about, as an Olympic champion, a world champion, and also a Tour de France stage winner. And I think, wasn't really Eros, the answer was how the Tour de France stage win was at such an important time in your life. And, you know, what was
it? Yeah, it's the Vontu.
On the Vontu. We're going to talk about that story, too.
Okay. Yeah. The Tour de France is before the Olympic game was just for amateur. So the top level of the provider was to the pass.
Yeah.
So I was gold medal, but my mind said, hey, probably I'm the best amateur, but I'm not the best provider. The best race in the world is the Tour de France.
Yeah.
Or the Giro, but Tour de France is really, really tough. So maybe one day it can be in the Tour de France, me too. Just for ride.
Yeah.
This was I didn't come true as a lead out by the Chipuni, because now, because I'm a tough guy, you know, I remember when I started riding a bike, I was a truck rider. I was Italian champion pursuit, individual pursuit.
Wow.
And I met a guy, he was just the winner, he won that year, in the 77, the Giro of Mexico, amateur. I said, look me, you're too big to be a rider. Okay, I'm going to see. This is what I asked. Meet them disgusted here. Hey, you want a day?
When you die in your
career, nothing. You just want to do Mexico. Well, go, Mela. What you mean?
Yeah.
So it's
197 centimeters.
Wow.
Yeah, it's how many centimeters?
175.
175. Yeah. What size of bicycle?
Now I'm riding 59.5.
Okay.
Here I go. Before, I drew a 100% bike, exactly right now, 61.5.
Is it the top tube that is changing?
Center to center.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Just now the different frame, but then pretty the same size.
Yeah. What was your, actually, it's funny, it's going to be two what was your questions in a row. And I'm going to ask both of you guys, since you're here, Andy, thanks again. And obviously, what we're doing is the 24-hour Zwift-a-thon. We're raising money for World Bicycle Relief. And you right now are talking to a world champion, an Olympic gold medalist, Tour de France stage winner, the only American to ever win the Giro d'Italia, the Tour of Suisse as well. And really, these two guys are taking their time today to give back. And I can't thank you both enough for what you're doing. And if you appreciate this kind of conversation, why don't you buy a bike? Is Katie's at $143 now? $147. You know, the inflation kicked in again, Andy. But $147, which is basically 107 euro these days, I learned. So that's really all we're asking is you think about it, spread the word for World Bicycle Relief. And we're going to get Katie riding, I hope, with Eros here as well. If not, we'll talk to Katie throughout the day about what World Bicycle Relief is doing. And even before we finish that, I want to thank the wonderful people at Zwift. All the way from the top to the bottom. There's not one person writing code there. There's not one person doing customer service support, marketing support, whether it's Eric Min, the CEO, Charlie Eisendorf, our fantastic friend who helped all of this stuff, McCarthy, you guys all go, and ladies go, Crystal, you, Mark, you, Eric, you, all of you. Really help what World Bicycle Relief is doing. So, that being said, buy a bike, please. So, guys, I'll start with you, Eros. Your favorite race. Just that simple.
One day race, Paris-Roubaix or Tour de France. Paris-Roubaix.
Best ever result for you? Are you always riding for Chipotle?
Yeah, so Ballerini.
Right.
48.
The
best result
is
48.
Yeah.
40. So.
You're
the best.
Nine times.
Yeah. Wow. 9 times to Japan.
In the Arbeck, Japan. See, it said uno. One race.
Yeah, but it's all the season. So, but for me, yeah. One day race is pretty good.
Better day. How
can I? My favorite tour is to Japan, of course.
See, and I think that most people here in the United States could really relate to Paris-Roubaix, the queen of the classics.
Giro di Lazio. One day race ends up in Rome and doing laps around the Colosseum. Yeah. Just as far as, then you hit high hills, harder. It's hot, it's September, and then we come in on the Via Appia, on the old, it's cobbles, but it's
yeah, Roma road.
When the wagon ruts, the original slate heads on spikes on the sides. Yeah. And if you take the wrong track, it's not like Paris-Roubaix where you get beat up, your bike will explode, like missing
chunks.
It's a big chunk. You'll break everything.
Yeah.
So it breaks up because of the hills, it breaks up because of that. It's regrouping. And then we do laps around the Colosseum and around the Forum.
That gives me goosebumps.
It is so tactically, you know, it's in the most beautiful setting in Rome.
Yeah. Who would be
but
more
likely? Anyone could win it.
Between two equal. Andy wins, maybe. I don't
up there with some climbers. It's like the Tour de France, the Giro.
Some more players. Like
but another group can come up and bam, just take off with 500 meters to go because it'll be a sprint. It's tactically, it's a beautiful, it's not a,
yeah, because the last 40K is
very important. You get to that, but not promoted to the right.
If the Strade Bianchi was today, that maybe would be one of your favorite.
Probably could be super.
Probably
too hard, probably too steep times for me. Well, that, maybe too good to domestique at the beginning.
Right, super.
No,
super.
But you could.
Yeah, also
you could regroup and leave.
Yeah, it is true.
It's hard. That's a good race.
And when you look at that last 2K, when you're into the old wall part of the city, I mean, that must give you those feelings.
Oh, it's fantastic. Yeah, yeah. Because yeah. As an amateur, did you do the Gran Premio della Liberazione in Roma?
Yes, I did that.
Yeah, 500.
Yeah, this is amazing. On the Caracalla
Vegas,
Spa,
yeah. Around the Coliseum, yeah. Fantastic.
25 ever. Every year.
Yeah.
So,
right in this group.
He's doing his watch. I don't know.
Yeah. Right on, Eros. So, once again, thank you all for the questions that you're sending in. Charlie is happy. He's got another batch coming in. Thank you, Charlie. So, we appreciate it. Go to the Twitter handle at GoZwift, or you know how to communicate through the console here. And Andy, can you join for one?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, sorry.
You
don't like when I do the commercials for you.
No.
The folks want to know what race is harder, and I guess it obviously depends on the edition. And I think this is a good one: the Giro or the Tour. Harder to let's go with harder to finish.
Giro.
Nowadays the Giro. Huh?
I think that's before.
Even before.
Yeah. Giro full time, Tour 6-7. The Giro was much harder for me. But more, not easy because the big stage of Tour de France is bigger than the Giro. But more rolling, but very, very fast.
What did?
Much faster than Tour de France than the Giro. Different. They're both very hard. But the Giro for me is very steep climbing. Probably shorter. Except for the stage, there's not one. The Gavi has not one. Oh, the other stage, this climb is very short, but very steep, and then a lot. Especially in the market, the center of Italy.
Up and down.
This is the other part of the Giro d'Italia.
And often, not every year, but there could be, I'm agreeing with the courses.
Yes.
Because it could be 20 people go away.
Exactly.
No one's in the first three, but someone's in fifth or eighth.
Sure.
And then there's a big bluff. And then we've had these 7-hour stages, huge stages, all up and down.
Up and down.
And you end up 220 man groups of chasing
each other.
Sounds
like what happened with Bauer, what happened with Chiappucci at the Tour, right?
But on a larger scale.
Right, on a
larger
scale.
A more insidious course.
Hey, Eros, before we let Andy answer, what were your thoughts when Andy won the Giro d'Italia? Were you a fan of the young American? Were you a fan of the...
I was a fan because I know the 7-11 team. I think that here there was Mario Scirea in the team. I'm not sure if he's a fan.
We didn't have any Italian
Olegio. Yeah. Remember the stage, because then, already the year after, first time the guy was curious who it was. Stata Bianca
just went and wrote it
with a group of friends. Wow. With the Stata Bianca, and then up to the stadium from Bournemouth to the top, the Sunday I won the race. So this day of training gave me a lot lucky. So I said, wow, end of the day, this is amazing, because it's never hand the Gabia, it's never ending now with the Red Bull Road. He made it before when it was Tola Bianca.
Yeah.
But there's no, it's okay. But
and the downhill's crazy too, isn't
the
it?
The downhill is very, it's cold in August. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
May.
Yeah.
So this is very, very tricky. The first 10K, actually the last part before having in Santa Cristina.
10K,
only must be careful.
Yeah.
No losing, must be very, attention?
Yeah.
Pay attention.
Yeah.
You must be very
focused,
but fresh. Don't spend too much. So this guy was strong because going down was not easy. But of course, we are from Boulder.
Focused, threshold, power.
Yes.
Do Do you know what that is? That's the FTP. Remember when that came up in your thing?
I believe you.
Yeah. Right.
You're an honest guy.
Yeah, no, thanks. You weren't even ever in the pain cave. Let's not even get ourselves. So, Andy, for you, the Giro, the Tour, favorite of the two?
The Tour is much harder. My favorite's the Giro. The Giro, of course, it's harder in the Giro, especially when I was racing, but... The only pressure I had as a foreigner was during the race. I could relax in the other hours. While the Tour de France, it's a 24-hour pressure cooker.
It's not
fun.
And that's not
it's the best, it's the most thrilling, it's my number one goal every year. But it's not nearly as enjoyable because my team, we could go to the Giro, a more interesting course, and anything goes. It's cowboy racing. I'm not being interviewed. I'm not an Italian star. Johnny Bugno gets pestered 24 hours. I don't. So I can just go there and race. So more fun.
I'm with you.
But the Tour is the Tour. And imagine number one.
Imagine doing the lead out.
Which,
Eros, that's going to be the next question coming up. But. And I'm sure, I'm not even going to go with the what was it like around Mario, but I have to think that that was quite a time to be an Italian cyclist as far as you have Pantani in his heyday, you have Cipollini in his heyday, there were more, Bugno,
Capucci,
there were more Italian stars maybe,
Ballerini,
Tafi.
Yeah,
I mean, what an era that is for Italian cycling.
Thank you.
Yeah,
that's where the world must die.
You're being part of the fun now.
Oh, come on in, Katie, right on. This is great Katie Bowen with World Bicycle Relief, and to be honest, Katie put this whole thing together, and Eros and you are friends. You have a lot to share out there, out riding and eating in Italy or America. Is he the best storyteller going?
He's a pretty good storyteller. It's great to have drinks and beers with, and really great support of World Bicycle Relief as Olive and Gamba is, so really enjoy Eros and the Gamba crew.
So Katie, I don't know if you want to talk business at all, but really quickly, how are we doing out there today in the 24 hours of Zwift to come?
Yeah, we're doing great. Over 157,000 miles ridden so far.
Wow.
And over $32,000 raised by the fundraisers who are participating in the ride. It's not too late. Everybody can go on to rideon.worldbicerelief.org and donate a bike or support your favorite rider.
Great, good. And who do we have? Do you know who we have coming up next here, Holly?
I think Alex Howland is going to be in a couple hours, and Meredith Miller later on.
What an amazing mix we've had here. So, I mean, in all honesty, Eros, once again, thank you for supporting World Bicycle Relief.
Really support.
Yeah. It's interesting, you connected with Eros's colleague, Joao, pretty early on. Well, World Bicycle Relief, we would say, goes back to really roots in 2003. You kind of joined in 2006, became a full-time person with them in 2008. And about then, Giles retiring as a pro.
Yeah, so what happened is...
A couple
years later when he was founding in Gamba, and Gamba's in its fifth year of operation now, Joao reached out and wanted a partnership with us since inception. And Gamba has always believed in giving back and having a worthy cause associated with it, and we're so fortunate. They're an amazing partner of ours, and to date, the community in Gamba community has raised over $250,000 for us, and Joao and the whole organization and Fansball is such a great organization.
It's interesting when you start connecting those dots and have these great conversations about cycling and wonder what you can do to help. I mean, you've met some people, like we had a dinner with Jerry and Andy last night and a bunch of other friends, including ourselves, of people that really do support World Bicycle Relief, and they'll make a commitment of 10 bucks or 20 bucks, and they really do, at the end of the day, we talked to Andy about the karma rebate. I mean, it really is for a lot of people. when you're part of that really nice thing that happens, that closing of that circle?
Well, I'm fortunate. I mean, to live a life surrounded by generosity is pretty special. Between the Zwiftathon today and on Tuesday was Giving Tuesday.
And that was over $200,000, I heard?
We raised over $200,000. And the Ngama community alone raised over $34,000 through a 10-bike special for Ngama World Bikes Relief Kit. Really special.
So you got to go to Portugal. Was Eros on the Portugal run?
Right? Next year.
So you did get to go with our Zwift friends, Mike McCarthy and Eric Min. And it sounded like you guys had just an awesome time. And this is how this works in a lot of ways. We couldn't do this without Zwift. And it really connects some dots that we never connected before. Well, we have in the past, but it's getting to another level, I would say.
Yeah.
I've been having those conversations with Eric and Mike when you're on an Ngamba ride, is how we're changing things.
Yeah, it's really special. I mean, I was part of the beta testing group for Zwift 2 years ago and immediately realized that it could be a really great platform to bring the World Bike Swift community together. We're a global community. We support us around the world. Over 80 countries represented on today's ride.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Right. So. Well, and continue once again. It was really nice having a chance to talk to Andy about World Bicycle Relief, and you can just see how the impact it has on so many people in so many different ways. What's the latest story that you're telling these days when people say, what is the elevator pitch for World Bicycle Relief?
Well, we're in a great time of the year right now. If you visit worldbicycle.org, we're featuring a story about two students in Kenya, Diana and another girl, and it really tells the story of what bicycles can do in rural settings when girls have bicycles. And we have a wonderful video on our homepage. Again, it's worldbicycles.org. I really encourage people to go watch it. And we're calling the campaign a winner, all done for dollar. So the effort today will be matched, double the impact. And as you know, Dave, you're such an amazing supporter for the organization. And as you know, like girls are really, truly empowered when they receive bicycles. And not only are they getting to school, attendance increases, their performance increases, they're safer in their environments. And we're all here today to support the power of bicycles.
I was just thinking exactly that. The power of bicycles is, it's so many different things around that young lady. But it's all of a sudden respecting, a little more respecting the community, a little more respect at school, from your family, from your peer group. It just has these ripple effects that just never stop going out there. It's like when you talk about it, and I'll talk about it, we have to be over 314,000 bikes now.
Over 314,000 bikes and counting.
Yeah. And you know, we still haven't really, if you look at how many people are in need in sub-Saharan Africa right now, I mean, you can tell me the number, but I'm going to say it's well over 700 million people in that part of the world. This will impact.
Yeah, our goal is to be distributing millions of bicycles in the rural communities around the world. I mean, we see distance as a significant barrier between achieving basic needs, such as access to healthcare, education, jobs, markets, what have you. So we're just getting started, but I do realize that probably a lot of people have questions for Eros.
Don't sweat it. Okay, perfect diet. Distance. Distance is such a big thing if you're trying to get to school. Distance is a really big thing, Eros, when you're out there training on your bike as well. Distance is a really big thing if you're trying to deliver temperature-sensitive age medicines as well. The bicycle is such a powerful thing. Eros, to build up, to do everything that you did out racing in that part of your world, how many kilometers a week would you train? A lot of time, I know hours, right? Usually it's time, not distance, but how many?
How week it was about during the focus of the season of between 600, 700K a week. With the race.
So, yeah.
Race is 200K on a Sunday.
So you're not in
600, 750, 700K on the doing 3 months a year.
Katie, have you ever had pasta before you go for a bike ride? I mean, in the morning?
Yeah.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
Not my typical breakfast, but I probably have had like a slice of pizza or two.
Donut.
Aside from donuts.
Yes. No, about my breakfast in the Tour de France.
Oh. Oh.
Yeah, please, please.
It's very good morning breakfast. Very good morning. So, I started first with the espresso, of course. And the espresso to wake up. Italian coffee.
Yeah.
Then, I love the French croissant. Seven French croissant.
Seven.
Seven. Yeah. You know, I think about the part inside. You know, the
dough.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I just put some Philadelphia cheese, light one, because I digest it. And
so we're already
strawberry cheese, jam,
basilic,
and cereal. Yeah, this is it. Another coffee.
That's it.
That's it.
So just seven.
Sometimes, small pasta.
Okay.
Yeah, small pasta.
In the big stage with the big Monte, Astro Omelette.
Yeah.
Okay. More than 7,000 calories a day.
What was that when you were riding, what was the food that you liked?
There was more panini.
Yeah, ham and...
Yeah, ham and cheese. Ham and cheese, because it makes it sweeter.
Yeah, yeah.
Sometime, same with the orange with Philadelphia. Philadelphia is everywhere. Banana and honey. Very good. And then some power bar for the finish. Uh-huh. Some jelly was the first moment, the first jelly was arrived in the end of the night. But no, it was. And some, you know, resini, how do you call it resini? Resini is a milk.
Sounds like a rice cake.
Yeah,
like,
we
could
ask
you
about that.
It's a rice cake, rice tart, small one, single one.
Yeah.
Two of those.
Nice.
Very
well,
nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Sparkly water in the bottle.
Sparkly?
Yeah, there are kind of a reason I drink sparkly water.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, it's very hot. And you're in the fit zone. You have sparkly water fresh. Mm. It's so makes you so happy in your mouth.
Yeah.
All day just drinking hot water, then fresh sparkly water is nice.
What is the name of the water that's so popular right now? You see it all the time at Safeway or whatever.
Yeah,
La Croix. Thank you. Yes, this should be the La Croix spokesperson.
Yeah.
You know what La Croix is, right? It's all the flavor.
Yeah, yeah, but, yeah.
Yeah, soda water is there.
Yeah. I'll let you take
thank you, Crystal.
Back to
yes.
Interview with them.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank
hey,
you so much.
Once again, this is that is doing so much, Katie. That's Katie does all the good work in World Bicycle. Man, she's such a nice person.
Isn't yes, she? Fantastica. Bravissima. She's una persona in gamba.
Yes.
You know in gamba what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a good person, she's good work.
Uh-huh.
This Italian name to say, you,
yeah,
you're a gamba person.
Thank you. Love you.
Yeah.
Grazie, grazie.
Prego.
Molto bello. honestly, sometimes you can just tell that there's something that the bicycle brings people together. Eating, good coffee, a bicycle ride, the good things in life all connect.
Yeah, you know? Now, yeah. Now, in my head, this is my life.
Yeah.
Ride the bike because I'm happy to keep it. Be healthy,
yeah.
Just permit me to meet friends and share a glass of wine and good food. Hatred is a cultural food and wine, yeah. And bicycle. So, I can't allow the USA because
no, I'm with you.
I will, yeah, they make me popular. I got men Olympic Games before, it's just thank you. But the USA, the American Olympic Games, I still call the spring. It's my second time here after. I'm back, I think, 30 years ago in '86. Mm-hmm. I good memory, so...
Well...
You know, people love memory, remember. I don't remember my past.
Yeah, I hear you. There's a nice relationship that Italy and America has now. A great appreciation for the Italian food here, and the culture. People like Italy in the United States. You know, you
I
see.
Know.
You, so, hey, I'm going to have a few more of the questions that are coming in. Thank you, everybody, once again. Eros Poli out there. We got about a little more than 10 minutes left with Eros. So I just really appreciate all of you supporting WBR today on our Zwift Fund. So The 100 kilometer team time trial is one of the most brutal events out there. There's no doubt about that. I can only imagine the mentality for a rider when maybe you're not on a good day and the team is good and boy, it's tough. But the question is, how much pain? Is that the most pain that you felt, sight or racing, doing the 100K? Team time trial?
Yes, but how it was a training. The 100K was one day, or 2 hours, was something, was food gas, was amazing. But it was amazing training. Mm-hmm. I remember last month, three training in a day, 6 in the morning, 9 a.m., 4 p.m. So, it was more than 200K a day.
Yeah.
So it was hard, and it was 6 food gas all day, in the morning. The second thing only has nothing behind motorbikes, with the motorbike, the coach, with the motorbike behind. So it was hard. The day of the 100K was his day.
Yeah, because you'd already done all the work.
We were so focused.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And then, it was
and the adrenaline is
awesome. Adrenaline.
Yeah. You know, if you think about it, when you guys did that, when you won the gold in 84, you were going faster than Francesco Mosier. For
2 hours.
Right.
When he came in, 100K. Yeah, special bike, like four guys, can you imagine?
He had a special
now,
bike too.
Yeah, true. Compared now, I think it's still a good performance. Because now, the bike's amazing. It was amazing, the bike, but the bike, there was more, about 15 kilos. Because the disc wheel was very heavy.
Yeah.
The frame is a steel frame.
Was it aluminum or spun out?
No, it was all carbon, the new carbon.
Okay.
It was a very heavy carbon.
Yeah. Okay, this one is definitely comes from a bike racer. I can tell. I bet you it's my friend Charlie. Or maybe my friend Riley Sheehan. Riley, if you're out there riding, you should come by BCS. We're here in Boulder Cycle Sport and are really, really happy to be here today as we do our Zwift-a-thon. And to our Zwifters, we're down to about 8 minutes. So this is a tough question. But I like tough questions sometimes. If you could do one race over, what race would it be? So you go back into your history, and one race that maybe you could have won, but you didn't do it right. You didn't play your cards right.
Yeah.
What race is that? And what happened, and what would you do?
Probably for you, but
which year?
Which year could be? Probably the day here, I was good. But probably it was no mentally concentrated, do not enough to be enough focus for the race.
Right.
Because normally it was just a mistake. To be focused in a big event as for you, you must prepare in January, February. It's long training. At Cancellara, I met Cancellara this year in Gran Canaria Island, focus in Peru Bay.
Uh-huh.
In the Strade Bianche. Me, I was racing just as a teammate, domestic.
Right.
So they said, told me, Eros, today can be your day. What? You know, team leader in the team today, you can try to get ahead. I do my best, but probably I was not enough training for the day. Do the best.
Right. Because you had been training to be a helper.
Yeah.
You're crazy. I know. Yeah. Well, you can't live life over again. You can't go back and change a day, but we can always go back and think, right? So this is going to be a tough one, because how do you not answer this with what I would expect? Which country has the best fans? I certainly am partial to the Tifosi myself. And especially the Tifosi seem to... We never had the incident of the camera hitting a rider or the spectator running into a motorcycle.
You know, if you, my dear, if you give a suggestion to some friend or you say to decide to watch the Giro, to come to see the Giro or the Tour de France, I say the Giro. Why? Because the Giro is so easy. It's very popular, so. But you can ride your bike up to the finish until half hour before the race coming. Right. No problem. And then if you stop in, stop inside the road, you start talking with the frozen, they give you a glass of wine, a panino con salame, and they share with you this nice experience.
Yeah.
So the culture in Italy is very different from France. They enjoy, but not have a big accident as you happen to France. Probably because it's more smaller. To the France becomes so big, and sometimes it's under control.
Yeah.
GST is more is a big event, but still under control. Mm-hmm. Everybody enjoy it. Uh-huh. The Tour de France enjoy just the get two person in the riders. It's not for everybody. The Giro is for everybody. Everybody can enjoy Italian culture or the bicycle, or the good lifestyle, the food and wine, and the speed of the cyclists in Italy.
That is such a great answer. People a lot of times will ask the same question, you know, what's better to go watch, the Giro or the Tour de France? I could not, and so when you look at it, I think what you said is perfect. Tour de France has become kind of a monster. It's so big that when you go, you want to, and I will say for the Tour of California, that it's a beautiful thing that you can still go to in Santa Barbara, go to Gibraltar, and be able to ride your bike. And as long as you're like an hour ahead of the peloton, you can ride your bike up the climb. Stop. You know, no one's going to be giving you a salami and prosecco, but they might give you a Budweiser. But the American style. But it's,
I love it, my style.
So
sausage,
rubbish, everything's brine, so fun, It's a beautiful life. And, you know, we only have a couple minutes left. I wanted you to take a moment for us because obviously we've talked about World Bikes. Ngamba is a really unique experience. If you're going to recommend to me 1 week to go with you guys. Is there 1 week, Italian week, or Portuguese week? Nothing wrong with Portugal.
No,
but which week in Italy? It's got to be Tuscany, right?
For you, really, in Gamba, experience is Tuscany. Yeah. Tuscany is our headquarters of everything.
I don't want to be climbing the Gamba.
Tuscany is amazing. Tuscany is for everybody. Mm-hmm. For people who enjoy, who relax, ride a bike, good for good wine, post car ride, with a pro team support. Well, mechanics, soigneur, two cars for every day, at the end, on the back, so we take care of everybody. I go higher with the strong rider, and then normally higher with the slower. Yeah. So I take care of everyone, I want to share my story with the faster as with the slower. So people sometimes watch our fault in the water, say, oh, they're too strong, too stiff. So probably this. It's a good thing for looking, but for enjoying it to go with us and the most of time. So it's for everybody. Everybody can enjoy it that way. All levels. I prefer slow level. So slow level, me go piano, enjoy the view, enjoy life.
Yeah.
I'm right fast enough. Yeah. Now people take care of the people who go slow. So easy, people very easy.
When the Italians came to Richard Lee, it was Domenico Vacanze. When they came to do Tour de Georgia, the first riders that would call for gruppetto, they'd be piano,
the
gruppetto,
piano.
With the gruppetto. Italians were always the first to say, slow down.
Gruppetto. Put the net.
I think I want to be in, and we're down to really just a minute left, but I definitely want to be in the gruppetto with you.
Yeah, you have a lot of fun. Yeah, for sure. It's the best gruppetto in the world.
So, I also want to take a moment to thank you on behalf of World Bicycle League. What you're doing, as I mentioned to Andy before, giving your time means so much to us. And I know that Italians have a big heart. And you know, every time that somebody in Italy is able to send a bike over to World Bicycle League, it means just that much more to us. So thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Grazie.
Thank you.
So that's going to wrap up another.
Right up, you got 5 minutes. Let's see some speed.
Come on.
So we're doing, slow. Come on, we're doing 55 minutes now. You can see how obviously this was another really fun group that we had out here with. Ooh. This is going to dim the power grid here in Boulder. We have, don't have that great of an infrastructure. Stand back.
How are we going? I don't know. Basta.
That's it. All right. Thank you very much. Eros Poli, Kim Gamba. Check it out.